Well, good morning, everyone. I really appreciate you waking up so early to hear my story today. So as you know, the title of my talk is Building Security Analytics Service Using Native XML Databases. My name is Mansi Sheth, and I work for a company called Veracode. It's a Boston, United States-based startup. We deal mainly in cloud-based application security programs. So I am a security researcher there, and my job there is to find security vulnerabilities from modern frameworks and modern usage patterns across them. So yes, I am not a developer, I am not a XML expert, or I even have not heard most of the XML stuff you have been talking in the last 2 days. So please correct me if I make any naive or innocent mistakes here. So I started getting interested in analytics services for, and it became a pet project for me since past 1 year. I do appreciate using XML as a metadata dumping ground for me and how to pick up information from that. So I hope, I expect that by the end of this half an hour, I'll gain consent from you guys that native XML databases is a great tool for any analytics solution you plan to develop for your business, especially because of its great processing power and really able to deal with lots of humongous data sets. So with that, let me start with this. So just curious, how many of you all have heard about Veracode before like 20 seconds? Ah, cool. I did not expect this too. So just to give you a brief, these are some of the services we offer. With the one on the topmost side is one of our most mature service and where most of my research is based out of. So let me give you a little bit more zoomed out version of that service. So binary static analysis, what does that mean is, you have your code, which is not in source code, it is the binary, so intermediate representation of that code. You submit it to our cloud service, we analyze it, we do a lot of compiler theory on it, and we find out all cool security vulnerabilities like cross-site scriptings and SQL injections or request forgery attacks or so on and so forth. And we give all the security vulnerability information to our customers. And that's when we just delete all those binaries from our system. We don't want to take any of those liabilities. And with deleting that, we lose all business information out of it. So that's what we tapped into. Like, okay, we are losing all this information, which is going to help us serve them better and make our business much more effective to use. So that's when we realized that we need to capture or start persisting a lot of such metadata information. So that's when we started writing some tools which will help us extract this metadata information, and eventually it happened that the best way to represent that metadata was in XML. So what exactly are we extracting? So I'm more in the Java world than Microsoft, but this is very relevant to any modern technology we are talking about or what we eventually analyze. So this, I just picked up a simple Java enterprise model view architecture application, and I have just exploded it in a normal Java IDE called Eclipse. On the left-hand side, I just want to get an appreciation that it's a very complicated archive. This is the most simple application you are ever going to see, but it is still very complicated. It has nested archives, and we are trying to extract information out of a deeply nested archive. And the information we are trying to extract is, a bit of it is shown in the next two frames of the slide. I'm taking a simple class file as an example. Again, I've just explored it in a source format, but it is actually the binaries which we analyze. So the information I'm trying to pick out from this, which is going to help me do my job a little better, is like, tell me the name of the class file, as simple as that. Tell me the class it inherits. Tell me the functions it is defining. Tell me the function calls it is calling. Similarly, from a configuration file, like just to give you an idea, most of the modern frameworks define their configurations externalized to the code in XML files. So I wanted to extract information out of this XML files, and that gives me information of what are the entry points inside the actual application. where are the servlets being used? Where are the controllers being used? It's as basic as that. So just to zoom this a little, how this maps into XML is, I'm just taking a small snapshot of a very small class file, and just to show you how it maps into an XML fragment. So as you see, I'm picking up the namespace, the class name, the inheritance and its namespace, all the functions and the APIs defined within it. Similarly, I go and do it for XML. Like for this, it's a simple struts MVC-based application, as I said. I'm just trying to pick up its action mappings, which is nothing more than a controller, and how all the action mappings are mapped into a XML fragment. Just keep an eye on that star action mapping. It's going to get interesting very shortly. And now how all this maps into XML. So this is it is just, again, a snapshot of the artifacts I just showed in last few slides, how it maps into a huge dump of XML. I'm just showing a snapshot of it to fit in the screen, but it will contain every single archives and nested archives in the huge archive which is submitted to us by our customers, every single class file in all these files, every single configuration files, every single files we don't even analyze right now. All this is dumped in this XML file. Now, what we realized very shortly is most of our use cases are extracting information pretty much from either the fifth nested level or the eighth nested level. So representing this in XML was the most logical way and the most efficient way to extract an information. And obviously with the querying technologies XML topology offers, it was ideal choice for us. I mean, honestly, we do dump this information in JSON, text, and all those formats too, but XML is what is most used right now. So now just to give you a glimpse in our day-to-day life, okay? So we have our customers ranging from we have around over 700 customers ranging from huge financial giants to healthcare to insurance to manufacturing to aerospace. And those people write humongous applications. So on an average, we are collecting this data from a little over 8 months now. So on an average, most of our XML dumps are in the range of 10 MB on an average. And we see around roughly 300 enterprise applications submitted to us for analysis. So after all this analysis is done, we throw away their binaries, we throw away all the intelligence with that binary. So we pretty much are in the huge destruction of this important data for us. So again, we have 10 MB worth of average XML files, 300 applications a day, which range from all technologies and all versions of technologies, from Java to Python to .NET to C, you name it. So we have around 3 GB of such XML files a day. And that way, we have 5 days a week, 52 weeks a year, which leads us to around 1 terabyte of this XML files. And we have a lot of services, which leads us to a lot more data. I'll confess, we don't store all this data right now, nor that we store all this data in XML right now. But we are pretty much on our way there. So now, what do we do with this data? Like, what answers are we trying to solve with this amount of data we are collecting? So definitely, we are not doing any analysis on this. Analysis is done by our service, by our engines. We give that information back to the user and throw away the binaries. From here, we are just trying to extract and persist some metadata which we think is going to help our business, to help us serve our customers much better. So just curious, how many of you have heard about security vulnerabilities like Heartbleed or Shellshock and like internet is going to fall apart? Awesome. So if you must have digged a little tiny bit deeper into it, you would have realized that ultimately it's an insecure call into OpenSSL libraries. So now for us, you would imagine how many sleepless nights we would have had to just go back to our customer and say that, you know what, you are using OpenSSL, insecure version of OpenSSL, and you better upgrade yourself, otherwise you are vulnerable to this and go and change your certs. Like, just that basic information. It took us weeks to get to that. But if we had a mature solution like last April when this came out, it would have saved us a lot of pain. And similarly for Shellshock or like insecure version of glib used for Ghost vulnerability, like it just keeps repeating itself. Next question. So as we have a huge varied set of customers, they use all kinds of different frameworks and technologies. And even they make us, they push us more by using most modern technologies which comes out on Stack Overflow or from GitHub or anything, like very often. They quickly start using that, and which exposes them to a lot of things because these frameworks are not defined by security in mind. So it becomes our responsibility to keep on being ahead of the game and keep on researching them better. So if we have some kind of prevalence of what is being used in the marketplace as well as by our customer base, it would be a much more data-centric decisions for our roadmap frameworks. So that's another key information we were trying to extract and make our work much more efficiently done. Next, this is something which is closest to me. So as a researcher, for frameworks which I have already researched and are being supported by our engines, and things which I'm currently researching or plan to research, I have to make a lot of scoping data because all these frameworks are humongous. I mean, if I sit down and analyze every single function call and try to measure every single function call and its taint analysis at every point, I might be able to support only one framework in like 2 years, which is not going to be helpful for me or my company for that matter. And what we have also noticed is out of this, only 10% of the actual framework is used by 90% of our applications. So once we figure out what that 10% of the framework is, we can have the entire breadth of customers supported in our most initial offering. So that's another security scoping we were trying to achieve by all this data. So hopefully I have made myself clear of what data I'm persisting, why I'm persisting, and what kind of answers I'm trying to solve out of it. So just again to clarify, if there is no other confusion, is I'm not trying to get any SQL injections or cross-site scripting information out of this analytics solution. I'm just trying to dump some metadata and answer future questions and kind of future-proof us. Now, obviously, we have tried a lot of things to extract information out of this GBs and probably a couple of terabytes of information. These are some of the approaches we have tried. I'll just honestly, very honestly say it was a very agonizing journey for us. Maybe one of the reasons is because we are not an expert in big data solutions. I mean, most of the solutions were either streaming XML files or they were parsing XML files for every single query we are trying to fire at it, or the post-processing is very difficult on the results that we receive, or we had to reinvent querying mechanisms for every single time, or we had to do a little bit of destruction of the XML representation into an alternate form so that we can do our job better, like put it in a relational database so we completely lose out on the hierarchical information of the XML file, or we had to represent it in JSON format for most of the NoSQL database tools. And that will not help us much with the powerful querying which native XML databases offered. So after the whole agonizing journey of probably 2-3 months, there was one lucky day when I embarked upon native XML databases. So after knowing, collecting all this metadata and dumping it and knowing a little bit of our use cases which we had in mind right now and what we think we wanted in future, and looking at all the databases we explored, I had quite a mini wish list which I wanted this kind of a big data ecosystem for Veracode to have. So obviously the first one was I did not want to get into the business of parsing XML files for every single query or for every single result set I'm trying to look at. Second thing is I definitely wanted to use the querying technologies which XML has, especially XQueries and XPaths and little bit of XSLT stuff. And I really did not want to reinvent the whole regexy rule base or like using JQ tools for JSON mining or any of those things. And this was probably one of the biggest selling factor for me for using a powerful native XML database tool. And yeah, I wanted results in a reasonable time frame. Like obviously the amount of data we were looking at, I was not looking at any real-time answers for my queries. But I at least wanted it in a matter of minutes or a couple of hours. Like, I mean, we had a situation where we dumped all this data in a relational database and we fired a simple query at it and we got the results after like probably 24 or 28 hours. By that time, I had already forgotten what I had even queried it for. I mean, I really did not want to get into that situation. So, the native XML database is fitted for all these three things very beautifully for me. So that's when I started exploring it more. So I'm very happy to say this is the current very matured prototype we are using and which is solving most of our use cases as you will see a little bit later in the talk. So just to zoom this architecture a little bit, we collect all this metadata we are gathering from all our clients into a single folder. And we have this import script, which is mainly a wrapper against the native XML API we are using, and a little bit of business logic. And we are dumping all these XML files in the database. And then the central to the whole thing is the XQuery scripts, which is what we are using for any kind of querying. And it's working beautifully for like millions of records we extract out of the database. And we are talking to the XQuery through a REST API and our security analytics platform, which currently, honestly, is a single page application, a Python Flask based application, which is just a wrapper around this REST API call. That's pretty much our standard vanilla architecture we are using. Now, security, we are a security company. I'm a security professional from like 5-6 years. So security is what we pretty much breathe all day long. So security was definitely not an afterthought when we were looking at this architecture, and we are implementing a few of these. So currently everything except the security analytics platform is running in an Amazon EC2 instance. So yeah, the native XML databases do not provide security or data at rest, so we had to find some alternate solutions to that. So our EC2 instance is a pretty locked down instance. It has a very strict access control on it. Only particular IP addresses can access it through SSH. Only you can access the REST API if you are within the company network. And we never wanted this analytic solutions to be ever exposed to the customers. So we were like, okay, let's not even bother exposing the REST API outside the company network. And security analytics platform provides some basic data validation routine so that we avoid any obvious code injections or code injection kind of vulnerability to the database or to the XQuery scripts. So this works well for us. And yeah, obviously we are talking to REST API through HTTPS, so we have our own certs going through Jetty server, so we are covered there too. Now, as you will notice, the central to this entire architecture is XQuery scripts. So again, as I said, I'm not an XML expert. I actually picked up my first XQuery book in October when I thought that I have to be a little smarter in XQuery to actually write a basic one too. So this is pretty much the pseudocode of XQuery scripts we are using to solve most of our use cases, honestly. What it does is it takes the XML through a command line, it binds it it's an external binded variable. That XPath is run on all the documents inside the database. If required, some post-processing is done, and the result is sent back on REST API back to the analytics platform. It's as simple as that. The initial part of the pseudocode remains the same. Only based on the use case, our post-processing changes. So with this, I hope I have given you a sense of what data we are collecting, what use cases and what answers we are trying to solve, and what kind of an ecosystem we have currently going. So with this, I'll try to combine and solve the jigsaw puzzle and show you how we are actually solving security analytics, our day-to-day security analytics answers to this. So again, I could not use my customer data for obvious reasons. So what I did is I went to open source. I picked up around roughly 50 Java enterprise applications, which are pretty much real life kind of applications to show how all this works. And I start my demo with obvious injection vulnerability exploiter. Enjoy it. Oh, sorry.
Now I'm going to show you some simple use cases which we touched upon earlier. Let's start by seeing a classic OS command injection and vulnerability exploits to application. The beauty of this vulnerability lies in the query string we pass. So as you can see, I'm passing a simple arithmetic expression as part of the query string. Let's see what we get back. We have nothing in the application. The beauty always lies with the page to explore. Let me zoom just what we get back.
Okay, nothing interesting so far. 700. Which is 300 plus 400. This proves that that particular arithmetic expression was run on the server side and we got results back. This is a classic way of exploiting any OS command injection vulnerability. Now, after a little bit of digging inside Struts2 framework, we quickly concluded that the culprit of this vulnerability is the action mapping, where the action is mapped as a star, which is a default action mapper currently. So our next step was figuring out which clients of ours are vulnerable to this particular insecurity in Struts2 framework. So for that, we landed up in our security analytics application, which currently is just a single page. It has two sections, a simple section and an advanced section. Simple section is when you want to find some basic standard information of a namespace. And XPath and the advanced section is where you can actually execute a long XPath as you need. So for this, I had crafted a simple XPath, not simple, but a fairly long XPath to get hold of our vulnerable customers. Let me zoom this a bit. So the way this XPath goes is, for all the archives submitted by a customer and the classes which contains an XML, that means an XML is a configuration file, and if it has a function called action mapping, and if the value of that function is a star, get me a list of all such customers. Let's see what we get back. Wow. So we quickly isolated our vulnerable customer. This is historically the quickest rapid response we could have ever achieved. Next, our PMs have a job of making sure what are the latest frameworks most famously used by developers, and also having a prevalence of which frameworks are most commonly used across our customer base. So just for the sake of this demo, I collected all the major MVC frameworks of a Java paradigm and kind of found a prevalence across our 50 open source test applications. So from that, we can see that Spring MVC frameworks are used in 16 applications out of 50. Struts 1 is used in 11. Struts 2 is used in two applications. So from this, we can see that Spring MVC is the most famously used framework across our customer base. So now the way this works behind the scene is, we again have a simple XQuery file which takes input as a namespace and returns number of times that particular namespace is used across customers, and that's pretty much the prevalence data we are looking for. So after this information maps into a roadmap, product managers comes to us researchers and say that, hey guys, look, Spring MVC is the most used framework across our customers, so let's do our best to support it as fully as we can and tame the beast a little. So at that point, we researchers, we go back to this particular security analytics platform again and start collecting some basic information about our Spring framework, for example. So at this point, we are trying to collect that, okay, give us all the usage patterns of this particular namespace and let's see what we get back. Sweet. So we see around 80 classes or 80 APIs are being used from this particular namespace. And what are those? Okay, it says that this particular servlets are being used. Then it says it lists all the tags being used inside this framework. It tells us around which view parts are being used, which multi-part classes are being used. You get an idea. Now, this information maps into our security scoping, and this way we can support maximum customers in our initial offering. Hopefully, by this use cases, you get an appreciation of how we are using the native XML database ecosystem using simple XQuery scripts for achieving some of our most important use cases.
I'd like to share some statistics with you. So far we have tested this ecosystem with around 500 gigs worth of XML files across a lot of our customers. So I tested with a query which returned around 16 million records, and I got the query back in 64 minutes. Now, I honestly was pretty psyched with this. I know I could have done better. There are a lot of optimization steps I could have used. But honestly, for our use cases, we were never looking for real time, as I said, and this worked pretty well. So the native XML database we are using is BaseX. So this is with the BaseX as our native XML database, this is what we achieve. And honestly, I'm a happy person. So again, I'll just give my credits to Veracode in general, and I won't be standing here if BaseX community did not step up and answer most of my silliest questions. Yeah, I'll take some questions. Yes, one more thing. I have open sourced most of the code I have used in this presentation on this particular GitHub, and the best way to reach me is Twitter or email. So I don't know if I have time for questions, maybe a one.
Yes, that was very interesting. And we have 5 minutes for questions.
Oh, okay.
Any questions? Come on. Oh, we got one here. Whilst that's going down, what XML database did you use?
BaseX.
Right.
If you can go back to some slide before, you showed that there is some pseudocode where you call the queries.
Yep.
This one. Go back.
Yep.
Yeah, this one. So this one is not done in XQuery, right?
It's a pseudocode, so I try to be very XML agnostic right now.
Yeah. So just why shouldn't you push this processing inside the server, inside the database? I mean, deduping, because you're trying, unique is you dedupe the result, right? That's what you're doing?
So, results is what I get back out of this query being executed
Yeah,
across all the documents.
and then you try to find the duplicate.
Yeah, so this is one of the use case, yes. So
Yeah.
I try to, like, because what will happen is if I'm looking for an entry point in a framework, as I said, I mean, only 10% of the entry points from that entire framework would ever be used. So whatever 16 million records I'm going to get, if I do a dupe, honestly, I won't be getting more than 100 queries out of it. So I wanted to put that entire post-processing in the XQuery rather than let the operating system deal with it, because otherwise operating system will have its own set of constraints. And honestly, XQuery worked better to deal with that kind of result set.
Okay. Thank you.
Any more questions?
We have time for one more question. All right. Thank you very much, Francie.
Sure.
Thank you.
Thank you.